And now private passions, and Michael Barclay's guest is the psychiatrist Henrietta Bowden-Jones.
Henrietta Bowden-Jones has spent the last three decades studying the mind. Born in Italy to an English father and an Italian mother, she's dedicated her career to helping people overcome addictions, both in the lab as a researcher in neuroscience and as a psychiatrist, treating everyone from homeless drug addicts to city traders with gambling problems. Your latest book, Henrietta, which I think you're working on now, is about the moment some people experience as a child or a young adult when they realise what they really want to become. And I wonder whether you yourself had such a moment when you knew this is what you wanted to do with your life.
Well, I actually do remember a moment when I was reading Peanuts, the American comic book. And in Italy at the time, of course, I used to read them in Italian. But Lucy was a very strong character, and I identified with her early on. I remember her in this little booth with psychiatrist written above her head. And following her stories, I realised I wanted to be a psychiatrist before I knew what one was. I remember asking when I was about seven, you know, what is a psychiatrist, as I'd already decided on my career path. And I pretty much followed that. I was reading books on the mind when I was very young, still at primary school, finding them in my parents' bookshelves.
And your addiction to music started quite early, didn't it?
Early on in my life, I was very lucky to share my childhood with a woman called Elisa, who was a character out of an opera, a sort of Mozart or Rossini opera herself. She came to live with us when my sister was born and we were living in Milan. She was due to stay for a few months and ended up staying 17 years. And after that, returned regularly for long periods of time to help us around the house. She was an opera lover who attended every single performance at the Scala. She would go on her own in the evenings wearing my mother's old fur coats that she would be handed down. She would talk to us in opera speech. But when we were little, we didn't realise this. All we knew is that sometimes when things became heated in the house, which the house was rather chaotic, there were always lots of people there. There was three children, two parents and lots of guests at all times. Guests who sometimes stayed for months on end. She would at times bring us all into the kitchen, close the door when she felt my parents were asking too much of her and start singing. Elisa su, Elisa giù, Elisa qua, Elisa là, sono il factotum della città. And roughly translated, this means Elisa here, Elisa there, Elisa up, Elisa down. I am the duo of the city. And it's from the Barber of Seville. But obviously, instead of Elisa, it's Figaro. And she had lots and lots of sayings. So when she picked us up from school, she would say, "Che geli da manina," when it was winter.
And your tiny hand is frozen.
Your tiny hand is frozen. In the mornings, getting us dressed, she would sing, "Vesti la giubba," and that means put your jacket on. And there are lots more examples. And the wonderful thing about this is the historical connection to my childhood that I regularly come across when I hear opera on the radio, when I'm listening to it at the Royal Opera House, because often I remember the words but didn't realise they were actually not hers, but they were part of musical scores. And she would be very judgmental about the types of people who came to our house. My parents had parties all the time. And she would stand at the entrance, she'd let people in, and she'd sing extracts from operas according to what she thought of that person. So my choice, my first choice, is very much linked to the fact that every time any kind of playboy came through the door, which was rather frequently, she would sing Leporello's song.
This is the wonderful catalogue aria in which Don Giovanni's sidekick, Leporello, lists his master's various sexual conquests from all over the world. 100 in France, 91 in Turkey, and in Spain, 1,003. Well, we're going to hear the baritone Erwin Schrott and who I think you particularly enjoyed, Henrietta, seeing in this role.
I did. I've heard this opera many times, but for me that was a memorable day at the Opera House.
Madame, il catalogo è questo, delle belle chiamò il padron mio, un catalogo lieto ho fatt'io. Osservate, leggete con me, osservate, leggete con me. In Italia 640, in Germania 231, 100 in Francia, in Turchia 91, ma in Spagna, ma in Spagna son già 1003, 1003, 1003. Ma fra questi contadine, cameriere cittadine, ma contesse baronesse, marchisone, principesse, e bandonne d'ogni grado, d'ogni forma, d'ogni età, d'ogni forma, d'ogni età. In Italia 640, e d'Almania 231, 100 in Francia, in Turchia 91, ma in Spagna, ma in Spagna son già 1003, 1003, 1003. Ma fra queste contadine, cameriere, cittadine, bancontesse, baronesse, marchesane, principesse, e bandonne d'ogni grado, d'ogni forma, d'ogni età, d'ogni forma, d'ogni età, d'ogni forma, d'ogni età.
Sapete quel che fa pure. donnella, voi sapete quel che fa, voi sapete, voi sapete quel che fa.
Erwin Schrott as Leporello, a fine voice in the catalogue aria from Mozart's Don Giovanni, with the Orchestra de la Comunitat Valenciana, conducted by Riccardo Frizza. Henrietta Bowden-Jones, you grew up in Milan, but then you were sent to a predominantly boys' boarding school, I think, in Wiltshire. Good preparation for a psychiatrist. Can you describe what it was like for an Italian girl to be hurled into the life of an English public school?
Michael, yes, there is much, much to say, but it literally was uprooting me from my country, where I had grown up there as an Italian girl. I was at an Italian primary school, and my father, despite being a Cambridge man, had never spoken a word of English to me until about a year before deciding to send us off. But there was a political reason for that and a social reason, because actually I left in 1977 to come to this country, and at that time the Red Brigades were terrorising Italy, and only 6 months after I arrived in this boarding school in deepest Wiltshire called Dornsey's, our Prime Minister Aldo Moro was kidnapped, and after 55 days in captivity he was killed. So things were very tough there, and I would only hear about them in the papers, because of, without internet I was very cut off. So I was the only Italian in the whole school apart from my brother, and we were very, very welcomed, particularly because of a wonderful headmaster at the time called Guy King Reynolds, who was a man of the arts. He'd been an actor at Cinecittà before running the school, and this helped me greatly in terms of feeling that someone understood the bella vita that I'd left behind. But we wore grey and brown uniforms, and we were extremely well regimented in our activities, and if you wanted to go to the shop you had to sign a book and ask permission, and I'd been running around Milan on a Vespa, spending my evenings on a beach in the, you know, the seaside. So life was very different, but I loved the school, and I loved the sense of belonging to a community, and that was really when music properly made me feel part of something bigger and something very organized. My life had been very chaotic in Italy because of the Italian nature. So I loved it. I loved the hymn singing. I loved hearing these voices. And I chose this particular hymn, Jerusalem, because I remember the excitement of feeling I belonged to the school.
Oh.
Tewkesbury Abbey School Choir under Benjamin Nicholas in Parry's setting of Blake's Jerusalem. I imagine that being in a boys' school rather helped when you first found yourself going into the then quite male-orientated world of science.
Yes, I think being in a boys' school as one of the only girls, one of the benefits was that I was always in the netball team. I wouldn't have been otherwise, probably. But in relation to dealing with the outside world, you had to be very strong. You had to be very resilient, whether it was preparing for a world of science, academically speaking, or whether it was making sure you were heard within that world and making a career for yourself. I think certainly that school was good preparation.
You trained as a doctor at university and then specialised in psychiatry. And as a young doctor on call, you obviously spent many nights driving around London. And I think you chose some music to accompany you. And it's not necessarily cheerful music. It goes rather well with the tragedy of addiction. So I'm surprised you perhaps didn't need something lighter.
Yes, I chose something tragic, not because I wanted to convey that mood, but because that particular tragic music lifted my spirits on those nights. And it was actually in the second period of training. So I had already done my membership exams with the Royal College of Psychiatrists, and I was by then a specialist registrar. And in those 3 years, you're on call once a week at night, or you were in those days. And so you worked all day, and then you spent all night driving around between police stations, psychiatric wards, or indeed anywhere else you were called to assess people and possibly section them, or in any case determine whether they needed psychiatric input or not. And they were very silent, urban nights during which I would get in my car at 2 o'clock in the morning, leaving my husband and my children in bed, and I would drive sometimes for an hour across London, depending on where I was called, wearing a black jacket, a black hat, trying to look totally, you know, unnoticeable, because it was actually rather a threatening thing to be out alone in the middle of the night like that. There is something in this particular song I chose that lifted one's spirits above one's own difficulties in terms of getting up in the middle of the night, knowing tomorrow is another full working day, and connected you with humanity and human history and life and death and suffering.
We've quite often had Purcell's Dido and Aeneas, and in particular When I'm Laid in Earth, but what's interesting about your choice is that it's from 1952 and sung by Kirstin Flagstad, better known, I suppose, for her Wagnerian performances. So that will make it an even more interesting rendition.
I chose this particular recording because it symbolises a lot in relation to the differences between my Italian background and my husband's more British, very scientific family background. And I had never sat with my family and listened to any music, because all of us talked all at the same time, all louder and louder to be heard. But it was only when I sat with my husband, who's a doctor, his father, who's a physicist, and the brother who gave me the recording, and the brother is a geneticist, and we sat and listened to this music quietly, and I loved it. And this was the first time, I think I was about 30 when I first actually was able to do this. So I chose it because it means so much to me.
Me.
Kirsten Flagstadt singing Dido's Lament from Purcell's Dido and Aeneas, a recording from 1952 with Geraint Jones conducting the Mermaid Ensemble. Henrietta, you trained as a psychiatrist, as we said. What drew you to specialising in addiction?
Several things drew me to the mind, but addictions in particular came to me as almost as a calling because of experiences I had had in Italy. I grew up at a time when heroin was a real problem in Milan. I used to walk to school, which was about 5 minutes away. We were behind the Scala, and it was therefore very central in Milan. I'd walk to school having to literally climb over people who were lying on the ground injecting heroin. And I remember the spoons, the lemons, the syringes, and this is a very vivid vision. Later on, many of the people I knew took heroin. I never did, but certainly many people did, and some of them died from it. So I've always felt a wish to give something back. And I carry that with me, an understanding, a fundamental understanding of the suffering that my patients go through because of having lost close friends to drugs.
After all your work on addiction, Henrietta, I wonder if you think that we are all capable of becoming addicts, all have the potential to be addicts.
What an interesting question. I believe that we are, if we are talking of substances such as alcohol. If I came to see you every day and gave you a bottle of vodka and requested you drank it, after about a week or 10 days, you would be unable to do without it. And that is the neurotoxic impact of the alcohol on your brain, on your body, and the fact that the withdrawal symptoms you will experience by not drinking are physiological. But in terms of the psychological predisposition to addiction, I don't believe that we're all the same. No, it is very clear to me, having worked in this field for over 20 years.
Is there a genetic disposition?
There is definitely a genetic predisposition. It's about 40% heritability in this area. And also early life experiences, adverse life experiences have a strong impact, as do attachment and separation issues. So some people are luckier than others in terms of being protected.
Let's have a piece of music which is rather suitably titled, given what you've been saying. It's The Roving Gambler. And what made you choose this?
I spent the last decade looking into pathological gambling as an illness. My interest in it started when I was doing my medical doctorate at Imperial College in Neurosciences, studying the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, and I realized that it was extremely impaired in people with problem gambling issues. And by studying that, after I finished the doctorate, I decided to start the first NHS clinic in the country. And when I began, I thought, and so did my colleagues, that I might just have a few people every week just to see my afternoon clinic. But as it turns out, the National Problem Gambling Clinic, which began in 2008, is now receiving about 1,000 referrals a year. And I employ about 20 people, mainly psychologists and family therapists, who work very hard to try and help these people who are suffering. A lot of them have lost their family homes. Most of them have lost their marriages and contact with their children because of the disastrous consequences of the gambling losses. But I have a whole collection of problem gambling country and folk music songs that I tend to run to at weekends because I just love them. They make me happy. And this felt like the perfect accompaniment to the more tragic songs that I have brought to this program today.
I want to sing you a Cisco Houston song for those of you. Disco songs were among the first that I ever learned. This is one of them. I am a roving gambler and I've gambled down in town. Whenever I meet with a deck of cards, I lay my money down. I lay my money down. Well, I've gambled up in Washington, I've gambled up in Maine, and I'm on my way to Georgia. Knock down my last game, boys. Knock down my last game. Well, I had not been in Washington many more weeks than three when I fell in love with a pretty little girl. She fell in love with me. She fell in love with me. She took me in her parlor and she cooled me with her fan. And she whispered low in her mama's ear, I love this gambling man, Mom. I love this gambling man. Well, my daughter, my dear daughter, how can you treat me so? And leave your poor old mama, dear, and with this gambler go. And with this gambler go. Well, my mama, my dear mama, you know I love you well. But the love I hold for this gambling man, no human tongue can tell, Mom. No human tongue can tell. So it's goodbye, goodbye, Mama, and I'll see you if I can. But if you ever see me coming home again, it'll be with a gambling man, Mom. Be with a gambling man. Be with a gambling man, Mom. Be with a gambling man.
Pete Seeger and Arlo Guthrie's Roving Gambler, recorded live from the Chicago Opera House in 1975. And by the way, you can find details of all Henrietta Bowden Jones's music on the Private Passions page of the Radio 3 website. Do you ever use music or prescribe it to help people with problems?
Very often. I don't prescribe particular pieces of music because I don't think that is my job to do so, but I have brought many patients back through the years from deep depression by encouraging them, sometimes almost ordering them, to return to musical activities which they once found profoundly moving and enjoyable. When you're in deep depression, you cannot identify with the pleasures you used to experience. Academically, you can say, yes, I used to love music, but you don't feel that. So I have prescribed patients to return to playing the piano, prescribed attendance at the Wigmore Hall or at the Royal Opera House in a very serious way. And people have said to me in tears, Doctor, I'm going because you're telling me to go, but I feel nothing. And a couple of months later, they come back and sometimes they're in tears again, but it's tears of joy because they say it worked. You know, music reached those parts that words could not reach. It brought me back to who I was. So I'm a great believer in that.
What is the psychological cost and effect of dealing with very troubled, unhappy people every day? Do you find there is a cost to you?
I believe that only some people are made to do this job year in, year out, for decades, as I have, as my husband and many of my friends have. I think you need that internal resilience to begin with. But if you have that, you also need that professional armor that you wear every morning that allows you to listen over and over again to pretty horrendous stories and to be surrounded by suffering. One of the things that I do is to run. I run a lot, and I'm not running away from a problem. I'm literally running to clear my head. And there are some days when the stories I hear still drive me to being very emotionally touched, particularly when we talk about childhood and children's sufferings, whether it's my patients' own childhoods or the circumstances surrounding their own children's current situations. And that, I find, you know, an hour of running is the only way to be able to get back home and see my own children, my own family, without that burden. The other thing I need constantly is contact with the arts. So I read a lot of novels and I listen to a lot of music. In a way, it's an escape, but it's not an escape from something bad. It's literally recharging one's batteries in order to face another day of suffering, other people's suffering.
And you bring all these things together, don't you, in your blog, theartofscience.com?
The blog was a way of being able to collect the interface between art and science that I have come across throughout the years, but I'd never really thought of doing something with. My technological skills are limited, but I have really enjoyed bringing the two together. For example, I was speaking at a conference in Japan at the International Society of Addiction Medicine, and after 3 days of intense work experiences where we were really moving forward on the behavioral addictions field, I went to the Yokohama Triennale and looked at art and was able to upload some of the art on my blog, and it gave me such pleasure. And again, I think a emotional release from the intensity of these very long working days. I love sharing that blog with people and love collecting new works if people know of beautiful things that have touched both areas.
It sounds as though you have a frustrated artist in you yourself to a certain extent.
I'm not sure that is correct in the sense of me creating. I love photography. I do enjoy taking photos. But I think I'm a great appreciator of the art, a great supporter of the arts.
And an enabler, too.
And an enabler. Mm. I believe that arts are fundamental to people's well-being in a society and should be given a space to evolve and develop.
Does this next piece in some ways sum up your feelings about art and science coming together?
Yes, Song to the Moon was a way of bringing astronomy and the arts into this conversation, Michael. I did give it a lot of thought. There were other things, but Song to the Moon, the beauty of this playing and the fact it has astronomy in it somewhere, made me very happy.
Thank you.
Stepan Hauser performing his own cello arrangement of Dvorak's Song to the Moon from Rusalka. The pianist was Yoko Misumi. Henrietta Bowden-Jones, on top of all your other commitments, you're vice president of the Medical Women's Federation. Why does it remain important for women in medicine to have their own organisation?
When you look at the statistics around the roles of women in medical professions, you quickly see that only 30% of senior consultants are female, and far less of a percentage are involved in senior medical leadership roles, such as medical directors. So from that point of view, certainly I think it's helpful to have a Medical Women's Federation to encourage and nurture young women professionals to do better, believe in themselves more, and try to achieve more. But the other perspective is to say, what a wonderful group to belong to. And when I first was invited to give a talk about my career at their conference, I actually hadn't heard of them before. So I'd sort of seemed to have had my whole career without ever having had any contact. But as soon as I came across them, I was very excited about the potential for mentoring and tutoring young female doctors who certainly could be better at wanting to achieve more in higher positions. So I joined it, and soon after that I was elected vice president. So now I have a big role to fulfill.
You clearly know all about the pressures that face women. After all, you've combined working in medicine with bringing up children. You've got two. Has it been difficult to make that work?
It hasn't always been easy. I think that with the European directives in place now for younger generations, things may be simpler. I did have years when I would be a junior doctor with a baby at home, and I would work all of Friday, and then I'd start again on Saturday morning and do Saturday morning, Saturday night, Sunday all day, Sunday night, and all of Monday. So I'd come home to a child who had grown since my previous visit to my own house. And I think that's rather unhealthy, and a lot of people do find that difficult, which is why they go in sort of more flexible hours. I was very determined not to do that, and had a husband who was also a junior doctor at the time, who shared everything 50-50. So I think that's one of the tricks that we have often discussed at the Medical Women's Federation, what creates a successful senior female doctor, a partner who understands and is able to share. But certainly the other thing is having extremely good nannies, and we've always had extremely hands-on full-time nannies who have really helped.
This aria from Così fan tutte, Donne mie la fate a tanti, is a celebration of women, but it's also about men testing women's fidelity, so it's quite complicated. The aria is sung by Guglielmo when he learns of his disguised friend Ferrando's failed attempts to woo his fiancée, bragging that his fiancée has remained faithful.
Yes, this choice of song was really more generally about women and how they can bring humour and unexpected turns to life in general. And it's about male psyche trying to work out female psyche, and I loved it because of that as much as because of the beautiful singing that is part of it.
Se verride ciò dir, se si lagnano gli amanti, li comincio a compatir, li comincio a compatir. Io vo bene al sesso vostro, lo sapete, ognuno lo sa. Ogni giorno ve lo mostro, ve lo mostro, ve lo mostro, ve lo signora mi sta. Ve lo mostro. Ve lo mostro, vi do signora mi sta, vi do signora mi sta. Ma quel parla cambia, cambia, tanti, tanti. Ma vi dice in verità, ma vi dice in verità. Mille volte il brando presi,
per salvare il vostro onor, mille volte, mille volte. Mille volte vi chiesi con la morte in quel far, ma quel far la cambia, 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 cambia. È un pizzetto seccator, è un pizzetto seccator. Siete vaghe, siete amabili, più tesori ci viviete, e le grazie vi circondano, dalla testa sino ai piedi, dalla testa sino ai piedi, ma la fabbia tanti, 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 che credibile non è. Ti credi vivere non è, io vo bene al sesso vostro, io vostro mille volte il brando preti, i difesi grande soli di miei, sino ai piedi, ma la patria tanti tanti, la patria tanti tanti, la patria tanti 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 tanti. Si gridano gli amanti, hanno certo un gran perché, un gran perché. Ma la fate a tanti che si gridano gli amanti, hanno certo un gran perché, un gran perché. Perché? Perché? Perché hanno certo un gran perché. Perché? Perché? Perché hanno certo un gran perché. Un gran perché, hanno scelto un gran perché.
We heard Ferruccio Fulanetto as Guglielmo in Mozart's Così fan tutti, with Daniel Barenboim conducting the Berlin Philharmonic. That love of opera, Henrietta, really instilled in you as a child a way that your life might take in terms of things in which you'd find succour and nourishment. And the final piece of music also takes you back to your childhood, Italy, I think, and to another passion, which is sailing.
Yes, sailing and, more importantly, the sea. I was introduced to the sea at a very early age. My father has always loved boats, was a fantastic yachtsman and racer. And when I was only a few weeks old, I was already in a cardboard box sailing around the Lake Garda with my parents. And it really never stopped from there. We had a home near the sea where we spent our summers, and I was always on boats there. And then in Italy, young people have much more control of their parents' boats than they would here. So it would be totally normal for us from maybe the age of 14 to go out on yachts on our own without adults and just sort of enjoy the summer days by sailing around. Since then, I have done a lot. I have sailed all over the world, always on sailing boats rather than motorboats, if I can help it. I've taken my day skipper in the middle of the Solent in February. I don't advise anyone to do that. But that was an important experience in terms of feeling that you can manage the risks involved. Lots of doctors, by the way, love sailing. There is something about the knowledge that is needed to, and the understanding of nature and the wind and the whole science of reading the charts that appeals to our academic minds, I think.
And also, you really have to concentrate on what you're doing in sailing, so that takes your mind off the day job, doesn't it?
Probably. I think that there must be something to do with it. There's also a gregarious aspect that feeds back to my childhood, where our boats were never just us. They were always us plus another 12 people who had sort of happened to invite themselves on or been invited. So there was picnics and, boat parties with my family. And even recently, during a very busy period at work a couple of years ago, I thought, oh, I know what I need to do. I need to go sailing with friends. And I chartered a gaff rigged pilot cutter and filled it with friends and did the classic round the island race at the Isle of Wight. And that was a real achievement in terms of these friends weren't sailors, but they loved the challenge. And it brought us all very much together as a team, working together to get round this island. We were probably one of the last boats in, but that didn't matter. It was being on the water and being in touch with nature and being away from, as we said earlier, all the sufferings and the difficulties that addiction and psychiatric illness can bring to people.
We're going to hear one of Rinaldo Hahn's songs in the Venetian dialect, which is a lovely way to end the programme. We can imagine sailing away on the lagoon, shedding the pressures of the world. So thank you, Henrietta Bowden-Jones, for sharing your professional, musical and nautical passions.
Michael, it's been a real pleasure being here on this programme. Thank you so much for having me.
Presto nineta, andemo in barchetta, i preschi a ciapar. Ad ogni godito, che il pese ne cava, per goder sta bava, che su
The tenor Matthew Polenzani was accompanied by Julius Drake in La Barchetta from Rinaldo Hahn's Six Songs in the Venetian Dialect. Michael Barclay's guest was the psychiatrist Henrietta Bowden-Jones. The producer was Jane Greenwood for Loftus. And you can download that programme and many more if you go to the Radio 3 podcasts page. Next week, Michael's guest is the actor Rory Kinnear.